Hello, welcome to the Daily Telegraph NRL podcast. I'm Brent Read, joined by Tyson Jackson, Pam Whaley. Finals time, you know, it's finals in the air. We've been at the finals launch this morning. We've all been there. But first of all, we've got to get to the bottom of that because you're, what are you wearing?
What is doing?
What is going on, man?
I made a silly bet now with the great Adam Mobbs, who is not here right now, but we were initially talking about getting tattoos for who would win and lose the spoon bowl.
Yeah.
I talked him out of that because I didn't want to mark my body. And because my great Tigers suffered a close loss to the Eels, I have to wear this all day today.
Just for one day?
I think so.
It's a bit used and unwashed. Has it got a stench to it?
This was actually, this jersey,
doesn't look a bit grubby.
It was made before I was born, so it's older than 21
years. It's an old school one,
yeah. And feel really uncomfortable in it. I'm getting a lot of weird looks.
Yeah, fair enough too.
And it's also a little bit small on me. Adam Mobbs is not the largest man in the world, so.
And you're ripped.
I'm not ripped.
You're an Adonis, you are.
I'm filling out this jersey quite nicely.
I didn't have that on the notes. We should start with that.
Yeah.
I was sideline for that. That was a weird and wacky game.
It
lived up to its billing. Well, sort of in one respect, but really disappointing end of the season for the Tigers. I mean, they've showed promise at times this year. Mm. And then they've had times and they've just looked bang average. And this was a bang average night. What'd you think?
Yeah, I thought it was fitting. Right? Just after the season that they've had, it seemed fitting that's the way that it ended.
Well, it summed up the way the Tigers lost that was how they've lost majority of the games this year, and just by shooting themselves in the foot.
Yeah.
They looked good at times and then looked bad at times, and then someone gets sent off and, you know, a sin bin leads to 60 points.
Yeah.
Look, I mean, the Eels, I don't think the Eels were great. I don't think the Tigers were great. It was exactly what it was supposed to be. And as a Tigers fan, I look forward to next year.
Yeah.
Jerome, we trust.
They can score points, Parramatta. They've shown that most of the year. They can score points. They looked at times, they looked, played really good footy in this game at times, actually. I mean, it's hard to judge how good they were because the opposition was pretty poor. But yeah, you know, if I'm Jason Rolls come in next year with this footy team, you stick Mitchell Moses in this side, Zach Lomax, you obviously lose Blaise Talangi. This is a side I reckon that should be right in the mix of the top eight next year, Power.
They should be, yeah. Especially with, you know, as you said, Mitch Moses being there more regularly. We obviously saw what he could do during Origin this year. He really is one of the best players in the competition, and just the hole that he leaves in that side is huge.
Yeah.
So should be plenty of change there.
There'll be a little bit of change there too, because we expect Regan Campbell-Gillard to go. He led them out. He kicked the goal. His second half of the season, he's been great.
Big minutes as well. You don't get that from many front rowers. Like I was at the game and, you know, you're kind of wishing he would come off the field for a little bit, and he was on there for a lot of it.
There he is. I would say the only thing about Reg, he's grown this moustache.
It's too long.
It is unkept. I was interviewing him for Triple M afterwards.
He had a little bit
of spit in his moustache.
It was out
of control. Like he hasn't trimmed it.
Yeah,
it's
it just
a
needs
mess.
To be trimmed.
It's the only thing going wrong with Reg at the moment.
He's taken inspiration from the great Freddie Mercury, I think. So.
Well, I expect to see
him. Did you say anything about the spit?
No, I didn't know.
I
should have said
you just waited until you got on a podcast.
Yeah. But
Reg is a big watcher of this podcast as well.
He'll be a great signing. Likely the Dragons, I would expect. He'll be a great signing. They'll miss him. I mean, I think he's been really good this year for them. So, interesting. You mentioned Jerome coming next year. You expect that to have a significant change on the Tigers?
Well, it's funny. Being at the finals launch this morning and talking to Stephen Crichton, if you look 12 months ago at what we were saying about the Bulldogs and where we thought the Bulldogs would go, especially like, Stephen Crichton's a centre. How much impact can he really have?
Yeah.
I mean, we've seen Jerome at his best. And Jerome is closer to the middle of the field. You know, he's a half. I think do I see us winning the comp next year? Probably not. I do see. I'm not going to say definitely not.
Okay.
I still think the Bulldogs have a chance to win the comp this year. So
fair enough.
But I do see improvements. And guys like Jack Bird coming, Royce Hunt,
Taruva. Yeah. They missed out on Corey Horsburgh this morning. Corey's Had a meeting with Ricky over the weekend in Canberra, and he's now going to stay at the Raiders, Corey Horsburgh. So that's a bit disappointing for them because they're in the mix for Corey.
But you know, it's a long preseason, and yeah, I mean, I'm just going to forget about this year.
I reckon that's the best thing to do. I know the wooden spoon was at stake, but I reckon you can sort of almost put a line through that game and just move on and forget about it because...
It's almost better that we lost because, I mean, at the end of the day, if we finish and we're all happy that we've avoided the wooden spoon, I mean, if that's what you're going into the preseason thinking about, you're not gonna live up to where you need to be, and there needs to be a lot of improvement there.
Now, you're obviously a Tigers fan. I'm a Broncos fan. So we should touch on them because they were absolutely diabolical against the Melbourne Storm on Thursday. I know it was a long time ago now, but that performance was disgusting. And they've had a shocking end of this year. Reviews are going on.
Yeah.
And the Melbourne are a very good team. But the Broncos to lose that way, it's just, it's not good enough.
No. I feel really sorry for the fans, I think. It's just considering the last 12 months and kind of where they were at this time last season and just how much hope and, energy there was around the place. And then to be sitting here now, and I know a lot of Broncos fans just turned the TV off. Yeah. Didn't watch it.
I wish I'd turned the TV off.
Yeah. Why didn't you?
Good Melbourne highlight reel.
Oh, Melbourne, they're such a good team, Melbourne. We'll get to them eventually. But, you know, there's been a lot of talk about, as I said, reviews in the off-season at Brisbane. There'll be some change there. Well, there is change because Kev's changing his entire coaching staff with Trent Barrett and Benny Teo going there. They might shuffle a few players around, I imagine. There's some leaving, but I mean, the key for them is you've got to get Reece Walsh back. You've got to get Payne. I mean, Payne was back, but I've got to get Reynolds playing back to full fitness, playing their best footy, because when everyone's fit and available, their squad's as good as just about any in the comp, but they just didn't fire up this year. It's really disappointing.
I think this season, and particularly this back end of the year, it's just been, you know, loss after loss after loss, and it just gets embarrassing and more embarrassing and more embarrassing, and you can just see them go into their shell. Yeah. And that by this final round, they just want it to be over with.
You watch his highlights, and Jerome Hughes is everywhere. I mean, it was a masterclass from him. We spoke to the captains this morning about who they thought would win the Dally M this year, and a lot of them said Jerome Hughes. He's been that good. But, yeah, that's what they bought Adam Reynolds for. And Jerome schooled him and everyone else on Thursday. He was unbelievable.
Let's not forget that, like, as poor as the Broncos have been, they have been without significant players throughout their entire season. That we did a list.
I know Ezra Mann and Katoni were the other ones who weren't Danny Stags.
We went through a timeline of some of the disruptions they've had during their year, and it's been probably one of the most unsmooth rides of any club all year.
Yeah.
Next year, if they get it right, it could almost be worse for every other team in the comp if they come in so hungry, because on paper and on their day, they can be the best team in the comp. They can they almost beat Penrith last year. They've looked good at times this year, earlier this year. They could turn it on again next year. I mean, this could actually be better for them in the long run, almost, to give them that real kick that they need.
They're going to have to take that out of it. That's the only thing that they can take out of it, is the humility of it and just starting from scratch. And hopefully they take that attitude into 2025. And that's the only thing they can really hope for now.
We'll talk about a couple of other results in the weekend with finals teams. First of all, the Doggies played the Cowboys.
Mm-hmm.
Got absolutely touched up. Second week in a row for the Dogs that they got touched up. Are you a Dogs fan? Are you concerned if you're a Dogs fan?
If you're a Dogs fan, I think you are a little bit concerned, but I think you're overwhelmingly, the major feeling is excitement, right? Because you got to take a moment, I think, especially before this first weekend of finals, just to go, finally, you know, we're here. They've been through so much pain over these last couple of years, and who knew how long it was going to take for them to be able to get back there. So I think if you're a Doggies fan, you're excited about what could happen, but massive, massive warning signs there for them.
Did you guys speak to Stephen Crichton this morning?
No, I didn't, no.
I didn't, no.
Did you get it?
Yeah.
What do you got?
He's not nervous.
Not nervous?
No.
I don't think he gets nervous, no. Steve Crichton, though, does he?
Finals is a whole new ball game.
That's, I think, he knows that, right? As well. It's funny, a lot has been made of this, like, Bulldogs curse, you know, every year that ends in four, and apparently they've lost to the Cowboys in the last round as well. I saw some weird stat on the weekend.
What, 2004?
2014 and
2004,
they lost to the Cowboys.
Ah. There you go, exclusive. Get your money on the Dogs. they lost to Manly a couple of weeks ago too and got touched up. And that's who they'll play this weekend. What about in terms of Manly? That's the other result that intrigued me, because Cronulla, they've been a bit inconsistent, but Manly are the ultimate inconsistent team. Like, one week they look breathtaking, and the next week they look diabolical. And this was at home, cost them a home final. They were bang average yesterday.
Absolutely. They started good.
The first 5 minutes.
The game was really physical, and I think the Sharks withstood that. And that's why they came out with the win. In games like that, you're looking to see which team gives up first.
Yep.
And it was clear that Manly got out of that fight very quickly, and the Sharks were there to play for 80 minutes.
Yeah.
You look at these pictures, like if you didn't know the result, you look at these pictures, that packed hill, massive crowd Sunday afternoon, you would think this is a special for Manly to win at home. I don't know what went wrong there.
Cronulla defended so well in this game. I think at halftime they missed 5 tackles. They probably only barely missed double figures the entire game, Cronulla. They were outstanding defensively. But Manly were just, you're right, Tyson, they were good in the first 5-10 minutes, and they just dropped their intensity and dropped off, and maybe they were looking at next week, I don't know, but they weren't great. It was a bit of a flat old performance, particularly in front of a sold-out, at Four Pines Park, full house. As I said, they're playing for the chance to host a final in week one, so... really disappointing performance, actually.
They have a young team as well, though.
They've got some experience, though. Jake and Daly, Matty Lodge. You know, there's enough Ruben Garrick. There's enough guys, Lachlan Croker. Enough guys in that team have been around long enough that, you know, they should compensate or make sure those young blokes turn up ready to play.
Do you think that Fitzy's right and that we disrespect Cronulla?
Well, I think we disrespect them because the last 2 years they've just gone straight out in the finals. You've got to earn respect.
I totally agree with you. Yeah, I think they have not shown yet. They just haven't yet proven that they have what it takes.
Have they fallen out of the top four this year?
No, I think they've been there all year.
I think they've been in the top four since week one, which is crazy because, I mean, no one's really talking about them as premiership favourites.
Well, everyone's kind of got a raised eyebrow, right? Just like holding their praise. Just to kind of see.
Because again, they haven't games, when the finals come around, they haven't shown they can get it done. Look, I think they're so well coached, right? He gets the best out of them most weeks, Fitzy. Like, he's obviously an amazing coach. Because I think they're one of the sides that, their lack of genuine superstar. They've got Nicho Hynes, right? But Nicho hasn't really shown, again, that he can get it done on a big, big stage yet. So that's going to be the challenge for them and Nicho in the finals. They're going to aim up, lift, and show they can get it done, right, on the big stage. Absolutely. Bit like in Newcastle yesterday, Kalen Ponga, who got it done on the big stage. Baby KP came to play. We love it when the great man comes to play.
He was outstanding. Yeah, I was up there yesterday. Yeah. The atmosphere was incredible. It was awesome. Yeah, awesome to be at that stadium when it's... Yeah. Heaving. Yeah. Got it done on the big stage. I genuinely thought that maybe the Dolphins, Wayne Bennett might just have one last trick up his sleeve.
Yeah.
You know? But I think this was a huge test for the Knights. They obviously, it's not the best way to go into the finals, is it? Having just like scraped in there, having to win your last game to get in there. KP today was...
Too.
Yeah.
I think they've won four of their last five, the Knights. They're in pretty good touch. And when Kalen plays like he did, like he owned the big moments yesterday, and that's what you want your best players to do.
Yeah,
he came up with the plays, the big plays that decided the game. Number one on the rich list, Kalen Ponga.
He was.
He earned his money yesterday.
Everyone should go and read that, by the way.
Rich 100, baby.
Daily Telegraph website.
Yeah, it's everywhere.
Do you think the Knights have found kind of a good balance now in their team? Where earlier in the year they... Seemed like that, yeah. You know, big name in Jackson Hastings in the half, big name in Kalen Ponga at fullback. And almost like too many voices and no one really standing up. Now they've all seeing Kalen does his job at the back. Phoenix Crossland does a different job than what than what Hastings was doing. Cogger's been pretty quiet, but he's just sitting there nipping away. They've got a live wire in Tyson Gamble on the bench.
They still, like, their halves still worry me.
Yeah.
They're not really elite halves, are they? You know, that's a worry. Like, if it's Kalen doesn't get it done, no one gets it done in that team.
There's been teams like that in the past.
There has been, but not many.
No.
Not many. and that means that every week in the finals, as deep as they go, you know, there's more pressure on Kalen every week to fire up for them. Otherwise, like their halves just aren't. They're just steady halves, right?
I think
not Phoenix many teams win comps with just steady, plain halves.
Yeah. Like, I think Phoenix Crossland, like I think he is actually quite an important player. I think last year, particularly when Kalen was out as well for that long stretch, he played a really important role for them last year. And I think just being able to find, like, finding a way to use him more often, especially kind of at the back end of this year, I think has been really important for the Knights too. Yeah.
Can I touch on what you said when you said they've steady, they're just steady halves?
Yeah.
When you look at the strike outside of them, though, outside of both of them, you've got Dan Gagai, Bradman Bess, Greg Mahus, you've got Kalen out the back.
Fletcher Sharp's a good player.
Fletcher Sharp.
Very good player.
Like, if you look at that back five is probably, you know, one of the best in the comp, in form as well. Like, if they can just simplify their game and leave it up to their actual strike, their big money players, I think they can get the job done. I'm not saying the Knights are going to win the premiership. They're probably in the top eight at the moment. My ones are, I'd probably have them just maybe like that six mark at power ranking wise. But
I wouldn't put it past them getting to the prelim. I think they can definitely win this week, and we'll touch on that game in a sec. And I reckon they can win in week two against the losers of the top four games. But I just think when you get to the prelim and they got to play potentially Penrith or Melbourne, I reckon that's when they're going to struggle a bit. But I think they can definitely win, get to the prelim. I think Kalen's good enough to get them there. And as you said, they've got enough strike in their outside backs, and they've got a good forward pack. Like, Daniel Safidi's playing really good football. They got Jacob Safidi to come back. He didn't play, did he, yesterday, I don't think. They got him to come back. You know, Dylan Lucas, a really good player. Frizzell came back yesterday. I think they've got good enough forward pack, enough strike and outside backs to win a couple of games in the finals. Mm-hmm. But I just worry when you get against the really elite teams, that's when I reckon they may struggle. In my opinion. Humble opinion.
Expert opinion.
Humble opinion.
An expert.
Let's touch on the games then. We start Panthers-Roosters. A bit of a blockbuster, this one.
Definitely.
Panthers-Roosters at Penrith Stadium. The last game of Penrith play. Knock it down and start again. do you give the Roosters a hope? What do you reckon? They're 0-9, their last nine games against Penrith.
Yeah, I think Penrith just get the job done here. I obviously, you've got to give Roosters a hope because they are a really good side and they have a fantastic coach. They you've got to give them a hope just because of the quality they've got in that team. But I think Penrith at home, it doesn't get much tougher than that, aside from probably the trip to Melbourne, which is the next thing.
They'll get Penrith will have Nathan Cleary back. Everyone today said he's certain to play. Mm-hmm. Tyce, what do you reckon? Give the Roosters a hope?
Yeah, I give him a hope. I give him a hope purely on that they tend to just find a way to stay in games.
Yeah.
Like last year against the Storm, they put 10 seconds away from getting into that the prelim.
I think catch by Marky Mark, no one gets
he was very good.
Yeah.
Yeah, Will Warbrick scored in the last seconds of their game last year. And, like a couple of years ago, they played Penrith in, I think it was a prelim, and their back line looked, you wouldn't even recognise their back line. And they were 2 points away then. So I think it's going to be close. I can't say I'm going to tip the Roosters, but, I mean, close games like that, they can go either way. It depends on the night, really. Mm-hmm. So if the Roosters are up for it,
Obviously, Nathan's coming back from that shoulder problem. Asking Teddy about it today, he basically foreshadowed that Angus Crichton will be just going at Nathan all day. They'll test him out, or they'll try to test him out.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, that's what Angus Crichton's been doing all year, hasn't he? He's just been terrorising those little halves all year. So, yeah, and that's why you have to give the Roosters a hope, right? They're just experts kind of when it comes to this point of the year, as Penrith now are as well, I guess. But
Do you the fact they haven't beat them in 9 games, do you think it matters? Teddy sort of dismissed it today. Do you think it's a factor?
Rugby league maths never adds up. So, right. I mean, 9 games is 9 games, but every game's different. Every year's different. If we look at Penrith 4 years ago, they probably hadn't beaten a lot of teams in that long.
Yeah.
But now look at them. So, yeah, look, I mean, smart money's on Penrith, but anyone that bets against Trent Robinson and his organisation there, they're rocks in their head.
I've got to say, I watched this a bit of this Gold Coast game, and Penrith to me looked dodgy.
They weren't totally convincing, were they?
Yeah.
No. But I think that Nathan Cleary, just him coming back into that team, they just can beat anybody. They're unbelievable with him in the side. So, you know, I don't really put too much stock into it.
Yeah.
Do you?
They've looked a little shaky to me.
Yeah.
I give the Roosters a hope. I don't think it's a foregone conclusion.
Who's winning?
I think Penrith probably win. Last game at home, they'll be pumped up.
Mm-hmm.
As I said before, the joint gets knocked down. Cleary back's huge. Depends how he is, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I just thought they looked a bit off. They've looked a bit off, I reckon. But they haven't looked as... And you would expect it. They've lost some good players, right? At some point, it's going to take its toll. But I thought this game, if I'm a Penrith fan, this game really worried me. Last game of the year, week before the finals, and you struggle to put the Gold Coast away.
A lot of teams were like that this week, though. To be honest, that Bulldogs Manly game that we're getting now, both teams are coming off losses. The Roosters almost let the Rabbitohs back into it after having them done. Panthers the same.
Melbourne didn't have too many problems.
Yeah, apart from Melbourne, well, unless you ask Craig Bellamy, who was blowing up in the box.
Yeah,
he always blows up.
The high standard.
A lot of those teams say they tend to drop off, I think, in the last round.
First game on Saturday, Cowboys Knights.
Mm.
Caelan's going home.
Yeah.
He spent a bit of time in Townsville, made his first grade debut up there. I think he made it in the final from memory, didn't he?
Yeah, he did, on the wing.
Yeah. So you spoke to him today about going
back.
I did.
He was excited to go back.
Yeah.
Wants to beat him.
Yeah.
So look out. But it's an interesting one. Obviously, Caelan's been at the Knights for 6 years or something now, and he came there as an 18-year-old.
Yeah.
Might have just been 19 or just about to turn 19. So it was a long time ago now, but everything's new in the finals again, right? Yeah. So a lot of things have changed.
Darren Mooney was the mastermind behind that, isn't he? He was at the Knights. He's now at Cronulla.
Yeah.
And they took a punt on him. He was a prodigiously gifted kid, right, as a footballer. But they paid him a lot of money.
Yeah.
And it was probably one of the smartest signings the Knights have made in a long time. What do you reckon? Who you got up there twice? Cowboys were very good on Saturday night.
Mm.
Very good.
I know. I've been anti-Cowboy majority of the year. So
they were good.
Why?
I just haven't thought that they've got the team to really win a comp. I don't know.
Not the team.
Yeah.
Itself.
Yeah.
The way they play.
And I just think there's been games this year where they've versed sides that they should smash, and they haven't smashed them.
They have been inconsistent.
They're very up and down.
They've got a lot of strike though, man. They got a lot of strike in that team. Lukey.
Dins, he was unreal. Those two were outstanding.
Yeah.
I think there'll be a lot of points. That's for sure. And I think,
Drinkwater's brilliant.
Playing at Townsville as well is a big step up because it's really hot up there.
Yeah. Queensland, mate. Sun always shines up there.
Didn't help you in Origin this year, did it?
Oh, okay. Yeah, we let you in every now and then. For me, it's good. It's the Cowboys' defence that's going to decide it because they're the sort of team that can put 30 on you and concede 30.
Yeah.
You know, that's the great dilemma they've got. But they were so good against the Dogs the other night. That was just an absolute carve up.
They just look like they were having so much fun.
And they did it so easily.
Yeah.
It's not what you want the week before a final, though, I don't think.
No.
I think it adds a bit of pressure being at home up there, too, and
the
crowd and all of that.
Golden Point.
Golden Point.
Yeah.
Well, they had a Golden Point game in round two.
Okay.
Jake Clifford kicks a field goal, Golden Point. The winner's win.
Ooh, Jake Clifford played for the Knights for a little bit, too, so.
Gamble responsibly, folks.
Yeah.
What about Storm Sharks? Storm at home down in Melbourne. No AFL on this weekend down there, apparently. So there should be a full house there. Can we see the Sharks causing an upset at all? No. They did win there earlier this year.
I feel like it's going to be closer than what we expect. Yeah. I do. But I am never going to tip against Melbourne in Melbourne. Yeah. I just think that that's...
And they get Ryan Papenhuyzen to be back. He had bone bruising, missed last week, but he'll be back.
We spoke about how good Jerome Hughes has been. He's just unbelievable.
The other bloke has found a bit of form in the latter stages of the year is Cam Munster.
He's got only played in the latter stages.
I know. No, but I mean, the last few weeks, yeah. right? Yeah. I mean, when he first came back from those hip problems, because he's got a double hip surgery in the off season, he looked a bit scratchy, I thought. But the last couple of weeks, he's looked threatening, Cam Munster.
Yeah.
And Harry's actually looked better too, I reckon.
He's had a quiet year up
until
this
weekend. His last few weeks, he's been good as well. So they're going to be awful hard to beat. What do you think, Tyce?
I think the Storm win. I don't think they win comfortably, but I think they win. Yeah. Like, versing the Sharks isn't an easy task.
No.
They're just solid everywhere.
Yeah.
But, I mean, there's no blueprint to beating Melbourne. There's nothing that I see the Sharks doing that can be like, this is how we're going to beat Melbourne in Melbourne. And like you said, those guys just all come into form at the right times. Will Warbrick looked
so good.
Unbelievable on Thursday night. And
Xavier Coates was back too, wasn't he?
Yep.
Was that his first game back? Yeah.
Like, and then you look at the people, like they've dropped Grant Anderson, who's been one of their best this year, like in filling in for those, those injuries. So then you got someone like Suafalongo who is there as well, just in case, that I can't see a hole that Melbourne can't plug or can't make up for.
What's Cronulla's best hope? Is it Nico going back to Melbourne and creating havoc? I mean, he hasn't really looked...
I think he's just got to be there in I think that it's going to be a pretty ferocious battle, I think, between these two forward packs. And I think he just needs to be there to ice the game. There's a big moment, I think, coming for Nico. And for the Sharks, we spoke about how they haven't really got the job done at this time of the year. This is now the moment.
Yeah.
And I think he's just got to be there and be around. And if it comes down to, that final pass or if it's, a sideline conversion or something like that, he's just got to be on.
The Sharks highlighted how they need to win this game yesterday. They need to stay in the fight and wait for Melbourne to give up first, which won't come, right?
Yeah.
It won't come.
That's
so that means they have to stay in that fight the entire game. We'll take one mistake, one error, one little glimpse of brilliance, and they can win. It's the minute they do what Manly did in their game against them, that's when the Storm will get over them. If they can hold that line for 80 minutes and or potentially longer if they have to, they have a chance.
Yeah, okay, I like that. Is Fitzy listening? You got your blueprint from Tyce.
Assistant coach.
Defend your way to victory, baby. Dogs Manly, final game of the round Sunday. This should be 50,000 plus at least, I would hope.
You would think so.
Dogs Manly. Not many Manly fans because we don't cross the bridge. Well, I'm not a Manly.
We don't cross the
bridge. I'm not a Manly fan, sorry.
But people in Manly.
People in the northern beaches, we don't cross the bridge. We might make an exception. We might go the back way. There's a back way. We don't have to go across a spit bridge.
What's the problem with the West?
Oh, it's too far. It's too far. But, I mean, this is interesting because you've got two teams who are coming off shellackings. They played a couple of weeks ago. Manly put the cleaners through them. What are you thinking? Which way are you leaning? Tommy Trbojevic back for Manly.
I know.
He makes an incredible change to that football team. Just his mere presence completely changes that rugby league team.
This is such a toss of the coin for me. I feel like this is so... I don't know. They're so evenly matched, I think. Manly, maybe I'm leaning towards Manly.
You can't sit
just
in the fence.
Tommy.
Can't sit in the fence in this show.
I'm trying.
You've got to make a call.
Yeah, Manly. But Manly. Just that crowd, I think, is just going to be obviously so Bulldogs-centric. That's going to be unreal atmosphere.
Yeah.
You'd like to think they could get the job done.
Yeah. What about...
Doggies will get it done.
You reckon the Doggies will win?
Yeah.
Yeah?
It's written in the stars, my friend. It's meant to happen.
What gives you that faith? What do you think?
I'm buying into all this history nonsense and whatnot, whether they're all...
The year.
Numerology.
It's not just that, though. There's so much to it. I love the fact that their fans are so passionate about their clubs, even though everyone else's fan base hates, going and being around them. There's just something. There's something, like talking to Critter this morning. There's something special there. He knows it. He's a proven winner. And yeah, like you said, Tommy as a reason that could probably tip Manly's way. Yeah. But for me, we've seen Tommy come back from injury quickly. We've seen Tommy get hurt again as well. So I'm a bit worried. I don't want it to happen, but like I'm just a bit worried that if. Is it too soon? He only got injured 2 weeks ago, and this is a guy that...
You're our resident footballer. Have you done an AC joint or not?
Yeah, many times.
Yeah. And did you come back in like 2 weeks?
Not 2 weeks. Oh, actually, no, there was once I came back straight away.
Yeah.
But...
there you go.
It's hard. Like, your shoulder's numb. Like,
yeah.
That's the problem with it, right? It's not going to stop you from playing.
Yeah.
But you lose strength in your arm. You lose feeling in your arm. Like, you've got... He'll be padded up on his shoulder, but if it's a bad AC joint, you'll have your joint looks like that.
Yeah.
You've actually got something like sticking out of your.
They'll just needle it up, bang. Tommy will be fine.
Yeah, but you're fine until you're not fine.
He might be a bit harder than you.
Probably he's playing in the NRL and I've seen him in a journo. I just think it's going to be a tough task for both teams, but I think the Bulldogs can get it done. I think best playing at a core as well. Is a big advantage for them.
Well, hopefully they turn out. Hopefully there's at least 50 there. I think Manly will get the job done. I think they showed 2 weeks ago how to beat the Dogs. Now, Camatrello's a really smart coach. We all know that. And I'm sure he'll come up with ways to combat that. But I reckon Tommy come. If Tommy's 80% fit, they're a completely different team because he just infuses that entire side with faith, with confidence and faith in their own, and he just lifts them.
A bit more faith.
Yeah, a bit more faith. So, I reckon Tommy might make the difference. As long as he gets through the game.
Yeah, I agree with you.
All right,
but I think it's going to be a close one.
Yeah.
I'm going to go backwards and forwards on this all week.
You can't. No, there's no, as
golden
I said,
point.
No sitting on the fence. Got to make a declaration.
No,
stick
I've
it.
Made it.
Stick
but
to your guns.
I think privately I'll go backwards
flip
and forwards.
Flop.
Yeah, I'll flip-flop.
I'll come and party in Belmore after the game.
You might have to have to put a Bulldogs jersey on.
I'm not making any more bets involved with jerseys.
Love the horns, love the carry-on.
I think
it's great.
I reckon that smells a bit, that jersey. Listen, what are you watching? What are you going? What's on this week? What are you watching?
I've been watching, it came out a couple of years ago, but it's a ESPN documentary, a 30 for 30.
They're so good, the 30 for
30s. They are so good. I love them, but I've been watching one on Michael Vick.
Oh, so yeah, he was a great player.
Yeah, he was an NFL quarterback who was just outstanding, brilliant kid. He was a first draft pick back in, I can't remember what year that was.
Leonard Falcons?
Yeah, yeah. And it was early 2000s, could have been late 90s.
Yeah.
So I've watched part one of it. I'm going to watch part two tonight. And just...
How his life unravels.
Yeah. So we had a really rough upbringing and then just was the first draft picked, got all these, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars essentially, and then had all of these friends kind of follow him to Atlanta.
Yeah.
And they just all lived in his house. And he ended up doing jail time.
Yeah, all the time for dog fighting. Dog fighting.
Yeah.
Dog fighting.
He was breeding dogs for fights illegally.
He had this house in Atlanta where all of his childhood friends and friends of their friends and everyone just all lived. They would deal drugs, they would do whatever in there. He was obviously off playing and he was just kind of like providing the money for it because he was just like the meal ticket out of their terrible life.
He was such a good player. He like changed the game because he was like the ultimate.
He was like a running back,
quarterback,
right?
Yeah.
And then so he just
now there's running quarterbacks everywhere.
Yeah,
he's a genius. What about you?
It was very good.
Oh, sorry, very good.
No,
how many
I recommend.
Are there?
Very good.
How many paths?
I think it's two.
Okay,
I think it's two.
What do you got, Tyson? Anything?
I'm watching The Crow, the movie The Crow.
Is that the old movie?
Yeah, the old movie with Bruce Lee's son, Brendan Lee.
Yes, that's a very good movie.
Why did you stumble on this?
Yeah, how did this come about? This is intriguing.
I don't know. I was sitting on the lounge one night and I said, I want to watch The Crow.
Okay. Had you heard of The Crow?
Yeah. Well,
there he is. Look at him.
I used to be a pretty big wrestling fan. And for people that know Sting, the wrestler,
he used to
dress like the Crow. So, I'd heard of it and I'd heard it was a good movie. I heard the sequels and remakes that followed
movie, yeah.
are great.
Yeah, I didn't mind this.
Yeah, I've just been caught. Some of us have to work, you know, and yeah, we can't be watching TV all the time.
No, well, we can't say NRL 360 or we can't say, you know, Friday night footy all the time.
So, yeah, that's been my, I guess, the 2.5 hours I had to myself. That's what I watched last week.
Nice. You know what I've been watching?
What have you been watching?
I've been watching The Voice. You ever watched The Voice?
Wow.
I love those shows.
No, I did back in 2012.
I like those shows when people come on and...
I do, you know, like,
They've got a sad story and then they sing and the chairs turn and the judges say...
But they don't get it. Like, you never see them progress from The Voice. That's the problem.
Some
like,
do, occasionally, don't they?
Some do.
Didn't someone? Someone did once upon a time. I think someone did once. I'm sure Australian Idol there was a few.
But,
yeah, there's been.
But
yeah,
I can't recall.
Well, Guy Sebastian's on this. He's a judge. One of the judges.
So we're counting one of the judges as...
He was Idol, wasn't he? What was he on?
Yeah, he was a champion.
Was Kate Miller-Heidke?
Yeah, Kate Miller-Heidke. Leanne Rimes. Remember Leanne Rimes? Yeah, she's on. She's a judge.
Yeah. Oh, is she really?
And, yeah, she's one of the judges. And that guy, what's that guy? I think he won the American Idol.
Oh, Adam Lambert.
Adam Lambert's the other guy on there, yeah.
He seems
so I've had a lot of attention. But yeah, I quite like the voice. I fancy myself as a bit of a singer.
Yeah, you do.
I think I maybe one day in retirement I might go
on there.
Can you
give us a couple of
those? No, I get up in the morning and I ain't got nothing to say. Bit of Bruce Springsteen for the fans. Anyway, that's a horrible note to end the show on. Thanks for joining us. Stay tuned all this week for the finals news, and we'll catch you on Thursday, I guess, on the Daily Telegraph and NRL podcast. Thanks very much.
Thanks, guys.